going on for many, many years, especially on the rings of Saturn. I mean, some of the power of the overstable mode of Planetary.
Actually, I've always been working on this since last Friday. I hope it doesn't show to get a different color in McMaster last Thursday. And actually, what I did is I spent most of the weekend trying to make movies. And you'll see the results. I'm more or less amazed at it. Okay, so what I'm going to try to do is give you some broad overview of planetary rings and then tell you about one particular aspect that's interested me for 30 years, yeah, 30 years, and which I think has now been resolved by observations made by the Cassini spacecraft at Saturn, and that is the rings are able to tap the gravitational energy in what's basically an accretion disk and excite modes, large scale modes of oscillation. So first of all, I'll talk more generally about rings. There are two major ring systems. There are the rings of Saturn, which are bright, broad rings separated by narrow gaps. So this is despite the Hubble Space Telescope, Saturn together with its main rings. This is the B ring, and here it's pretty much opaque, has an optical depth significantly greater than it would be in most parts. Here's the A ring, its optical depth is a bit less than unity. They're separated by this gap, which is known as the Cassini division. And the outer edge of the B ring, which forms the inner edge of the Cassini division, is maintained by torques from the satellite, which is not in this image. The innermost of the large satellites of Saturn and Venus. And mostly I'll be talking in the later part of the lecture about the behavior of the shape of the outer edge of the B ring. We have the A-ring. The A-ring is quite smooth. Most of the features in the A-ring are spiral density waves, like the spiral density waves in galaxies, but better understood, much shorter wavelength. There's a gap here, the Encke gap, which I'll show you an image of in a little while. And this is maintained open by a small satellite called Pan. Then we come to the outer edge of the A-ring. And that's maintained in very sharp configurations by a pair of satellites called colloidal satellites. It has a sevenfold shape. The Cassini division has mainly over my requirement m equals 2 or cosine 2 phi perturbation of the shape. Okay, one of the interesting things about these rings is that, as I said, they're basically accretion disks. They're made up of ice particles which range in size from centimeters to several meters. It's not at all clear why there are smaller particles. In most distributions of particles that we know about, most of the area is very small particles. Most of the masses are large particles. Well, in Saturn's rings, most of the masses are these meter-sized particles, but there's almost no area in particles smaller than centimeters. Another interesting thing about these rings is because the inner, the particles basically orbit Capitarian orbits, like you think of the rings as being a giant superhighway, and the particles are whizzing around at around 20 kilometers per second, but they encounter each other with velocities that are about a millimeter per second or less. That is, in neighboring lanes, each particle is very well behaved. They travel at very nearly the same speeds. So they only nudge each other when they pass each other. But even this little bit of nudging causes an outward transport of angular momentum to the viscosity in the disk, which is maintained by particle collisions. And that transports angular momentum from the inner part of the disk to the outer part. It has to jump across these gaps or jump somewhere. And it gets to the edge of the ring, the angular momentum has to jump to the satellites that maintain the edge of these rings. And these rings have radius somewhat greater than 100,000 kilometers, but the transitions between ring and empty space are incredibly sharp. They're sharp on a scale of 100 meters. Imagine walking along some feet around the Earth, where, in this case, maybe hundreds of kilometers, all of a sudden coming to a ledge, and the ledge is sharp, millimeters or so, quite a lot. And that's what you have here. So we'll talk a little bit about how these edges are maintained, although not too much. That's not the main subject of my talk. Okay, so that's a sort of broad brush view. On now, here's just a pretty picture that I put down. I was trying to take a talk this morning because all I had done was make movies all weekend. And so I found this one. This is a nice picture looking back towards the sun from the Cassini spacecraft, where Saturn blocking out the light. Rings, and then you see that there's some diffuse material outside the main rings. Again, not something I'm going to talk about. But some of it's quite interesting. And its origin is interesting. Okay, now here's the Encke division. This is the smaller of the divisions, the one that was in the A ring. And here's that satellite pan. Now what pan does is it takes the angular momentum that's coming from inside the inner edge of the Encke division, it grabs it, and then it transfers it to the material that's on the outside of the Encke division. And that way it prevents the division from viscously closing, which it otherwise would do in short order. By short order, I mean much less time than the age of the solar system. Now the reason I'm showing this picture, aside from the fact that it's a pretty picture, is it shows just how flat the rings are. Pan is maybe 10 kilometers or so in diameter. This, in radius, this gap is 340 kilometers wide. It makes a great two-slit diffraction pattern for the radio waves that the spacecraft that's behind the rings. With respect to the Earth, it beams back to the Earth. Anyway, what I'm showing here is a shadow that's cast by Pan at low sun angle. So this picture was taken when the sun is almost in the ring plane. You can see this very long shadow, like thousands, tens of thousands of kilometers away from Pan. Pan's only sticking up by more than 10 kilometers above and below the ring plane. It just shows you how flat the ring plane, how far you could see if you could stick your hand up here. Now, sometime in the near future, there may be a spacecraft which hovers just above the rings, and then we'll be able to look out along this great expanse. Okay, so that's one indication. We know that these rings are almost a monolayer thick. They're not thicker than perhaps 10 meters or so. An extremely thin system. And that's illustrated more graphically, although not exactly, but precisely. And this image also taken here, ring plane crossing. Here are the rings. These are a couple of external satellites. And looking at the edge on, you see that they're extremely sharp. But actually, they're not exactly flat. They're almost plane. Held together by, held in place by the oblate, the quadrupole moment of the oblate figure of Saturn. But in fact, they're warped a little bit, and in some places, they're actually bent up from bending waves. And also, the material can splash up a little out of these rings. So they're not exactly flat, but they're very, very thin. Okay, now I'm going to go through the other set of rings. These are the uranium rings. We're not exactly sure what the uranium rings are made out of. We think probably almost completely of ice, mostly water ice and some methane ice. But unlike the Saturn's rings, which are very bright and very high albedo, also show features, spectral features and reflection of water ice. The uranium rings are extremely dark. They're darker than cold light. But in fact, the 2 microns, they're quite a bit brighter than the planet, because the planet has methane in its atmosphere. The 2 microns, the albedo of the planet is 10^-4, the albedo of the rings is 10^-2. So the rings can actually be seen in reflected sunlight, even though they're very far from the sun, without the planet, the 2 microns. And here is about as well as you can do of Earth as an HST image. This outer ring is called the Epsilon ring. It's the broadest, brightest, and most massive of all the rings that are Uranus. And then you can see a few other rings inside here. It's amazing that these things can be resolved. The Uranian rings were discovered by a number of groups, most notably one using the CITA F1 observatory led by Jim Elliott in 1977. They provided a big contrast to the rings of Saturn, because these rings are dark and narrow and have light gaps between them. You can't see how wide the gaps are by looking at an image with this resolution, but if you look at it at a somewhat higher resolution image, you see how narrow these rings really are. This is the curvature of the ring. The planet, of course, is all the way down here somewhere. These rings have radii, orbital radii, from the center of Uranus, about 50,000 kilometers. These rings, you can barely see these, it's called 354, this is alpha, beta, this is gamma, and this is delta, and this is epsilon. And epsilon, of course, is the widest one. Epsilon has a width which varies by about a factor of 5 between it's an elliptical ring. Its ellipticity is about 1%. And in periapse, its width is about 20 kilometers, and in apoapse, its width is about 100 kilometers. Because the particles are flowing around in the ring, but the ring shape is only very slowly precessing, about 1.4 degrees per day. Particles going around in something less than a day, maybe about half a day. Okay, so this is an example of... the rings like these would spread very, very quickly. Just through the particle collisions, they would spread very, very quickly. So the fact that they're still nice and narrow, stay confined in some very significant time, means that something has to be holding them together. Something has to be putting angular momentum into the inner edge of each of these rings to keep it from spreading inward, and taking angular momentum out of the outer edge of the ring to keep the outer edge from spreading out. Want to understand planetary rings, you always have to understand angular momentum. Angular momentum is the conserved quantum. When I used to lecture about this stuff many, many years ago, I used to say you should remember on the deep throat of the investigators in Watergate. So if you want to understand what happened, follow the money. Well, in planetary rings, you want to follow the angular momentum. Particle collisions dissipate energy, but they don't dissipate angular momentum. And so follow the angular momentum, you can get a pretty good idea of what has to be around in order to make these rings the way they are, even if you can't see it.
If you look at the couple of very powerful engines,
there are wisps in the engines. Yeah. It's not completely clean. Okay. So in the case of the is epsilon ring, biggest and most massive of the rings. By the way, this ring has a mass something like that. The satellite with a radius maybe 10 kilometers or so. So that's the 18th to the 19th mass. And what's doing is holding together the epsilon ring of these two satellites, which are called Shepard satellites. They raise tides on the edges of these rings. This satellite is in a 25-24 resonance with the inner edge of the ring, within a fraction of a kilometer accuracy. So the semi-major axis at the inner edge of the ring, particles moving along the inner edge of the ring, orbit 24 times from 25 times the satellite comes around. In this case, it's like 14-13 resonance. And careful studies by Dick French, Phil Nicholson, and others of many occultations over a decade, stellar occultations, measuring the edges, positions of the edges of these rings at different longitudes, different azimuths, that's just allowed for by available occultations, have revealed weightiness in the edges of about half a kilometer, which is consistent. An amplitude of predictions of what you would get from the satellites, and more notably, at just the right phase, just the right angular phase. So these edges are really wavy, although you can't, of course, see it on this image.
Are you aware of the material came from in the first place? Once it's there, you can keep it there, but...
No, presumably, my guess would be that the satellites and rings interchange. In other words, if the satellites break up, other satellites focus the material from up into a ring, and then over time, the ring may even reform with a satellite. But we don't really know. Anybody's guess at the moment.
But the fact is coplanar.
All these rings, or almost all these rings, are eccentric. This one's the most eccentric, as I said, about 1%. The others are somewhat less eccentric. And aside from this one, I think all of these are inclined, but only by a very, very little estimate of these. But they're very close to coplanar. And they're also in the equator plane of Uranus. And so this picture, like this picture was taken, Voyager spacecraft was penetrating and approaching the system almost perpendicular to the open plane of the rings. And but they're very nearly coplanar. By the standards of planetary orbits in the solar system, or the extra solar planetary system studied by Kepler, these are still quite complicated. And they're locked to the equator plane of Uranus. So that tells you something, but it depends on how you think Uranus like tip in almost 90 degrees, all the way on spin axis. The satellites of Uranus also are all in essentially in the same plane as the rings, in the plane of the equator. The ring material might collect again through collisions into the equator plane of a planet if the planet were knocked over in a collision. But the satellite orbits never would. So the fact that the satellite orbits are all in the equator plane of the Earth is telling you that either they formed after the Earth, or any plane, rapidly shifted in a collision, or there was never a collision. There was another reason why the ring spin is not normal to nearly normal to the orbit plane. They both have arguments for and against, which are pretty good. Okay, so now unfortunately, we're going to stop pictures for a while, and I'm going to talk. So I just want to say a few things about the dynamics of rings. I've already told you particle collision is transferring momentum, and there's some random velocity. The random velocities, best we can tell, more or less equal to the overlangular velocity times the radius of the biggest particle in these rings. You have a particle which is meter across, and the overlangular velocity is 10 to the minus 4 radians per second. Then you're talking about 10 to the millimeter per second random velocity. And then your thickness is like a meter. Probably so much greater than that, because we know there are particles of several meters from diffraction peak scattering of radio signal in this. And that's more or less what we know. Okay, now, one of the main features that was predicted and then later observed in these rings were density waves. And density waves, these are just the density waves of Lynch-Shrew theory, they obey the predictions of theory in the ones of galaxies. But these are driven, or at least most of the density waves that were observed in these rings, by Voyager, and about 30 wave trains observed by Voyager, and hundreds now, like you see me. These are driven waves. They're driven by satellites. A satellite uses a tidal perturbation in the rings, and there's a radii in which these tidal perturbations have a time dependence as felt by particles orbiting in the rings. It just matches the natural in and out frequency of the particle would like to make, which is called its epicyclic frequency, which in the Keplerian disk is very close to the orbital frequency. And in these places, in these resonances, in which the particles can be tickled, their natural inclination to oscillate relative to circular orbit. These are called Lindblad resonances. And for any satellite with a given circular overlying velocity, there can be two resonances, the inner Lindblad resonance and the outer Lindblad resonance. But if the satellite is orbiting outside the rings, then it's only the inner Lindblad resonance that matters. And at an inner Lindblad resonance, these tides, all the particles, produce a disturbance which propagates outward, back towards the satellite, and carries negative angular momentum and energy. And the propagation of this disturbance, which is a spiral density wave, is very, very slow. It's at a speed of order of millimeter per second. Still, over a year, only in the millimeter per second, you can go around 30 kilometers. And these waves, even ones that are generated by modest-sized satellites, can carry an amount of negative energy. You might ask what is negative energy, but negative energy comparable to positive energy generated by a mid-sized power plant on Earth. And these waves carry a conserved flux, or conserved luminosity of energy and angular momentum, as long as they're not damped. If they damp, then the energy and angular momentum goes to the material where they damp. And if they're carrying negative energy and angular momentum, and they damp it, if they're damped, then that negative energy and angular momentum causes the ring material to slowly inward. So the rings not only carry the stuff, but they also sculpt. I mean, the waves, they also sculpt the rings. And that's one of the problems, because if you have a wave going on for a long time, it actually starts to affect the medium through which it propagates. That makes the approximation that it's a wave on a uniform background a less good approximation. And we've only gone some way understanding that. So that's a problem. Density waves. And also, much less frequent examples are bending waves, in which a satellite that's not in the ring plane, even by a degree or so, produces corrugation of the ring, bending waves. They're easy to distinguish. But when you look at these in an image, all you see is narrowly spaced over a small range of azimuth. Lighter and darker regions. You don't get a concept of a real spiral wave. This picture here is a representation of such a deep waves based on data taken in stellar occultations. 13 stellar occultations. So there were 13 stars observed passing behind the rings as seen by the spacecraft. And the light from these stars was monitored. This was in the A ring, so quite a bit of the light went through, somewhat more than half typically. And the as a function of time, as each of these occultations occurred, the light intensity was measured. In this case, a measure of optical depth along 13 paths through the rings. And then it was known from previous work that this ring, or the certain part of the A ring, had a resonance which gave rise to a density wave with the satellite Venus. It was a 5-3 resonance. Venus went around 5 times, maybe 3 times the material band. Was going around. And Nicole Rappaport, in my suggestion, took advantage of the fact that you could tie all of these occultations, cell occultations together, and use the fourfold symmetry that the theory told you there would be at this particular resonance to make a four-arm spiral pattern just from the data. And that you could do this and by smoothing, just treating as a smooth function, the optical depth is a function of azimuth and radius. And look how many, and here are the four arms, one there, one there, one there, one there. And look at these are the crest and optical depth here. Here and across. Look at all the arms. Notice how as you go away from the resonance, the little flat resonance is right in here. As you go away from the resonance, the winding of these arms becomes tighter and tighter. Now, this whole system, so what's been done here is use the fourfold symmetry and the known pattern speed, which comes from the orbital properties of the satellite. To connect all of these occultations, which have taken in some cases years apart. And you then get this very nice structure.
Okay, this is stretched very good.
Right?
This is stretched.
Oh, yeah, excuse me, yes. It's been grossly stretched very regularly. This circumference, or the radius here, is around 100,000 kilometers, a little bit more. And the whole system here is only a couple hundred kilometers, and so it's been stretched. Now the reason these waves arms get more and more tightly wound as you go out, is that in order to maintain a coherent wave pattern, The particle's self-gravity, the gravity of this fluid of particles, you should think of it as self-gravitating fluid of particles, has to produce gravity gradients which adjust the epicyclic frequency, the radially in and out frequency, away from that which a free particle would have at a particular radius. And they don't have to do any adjustment right at the radius of the lid-lead resonance. Let's go farther and farther away. More and more adjustment is needed. And in order to get that adjustment, since the amplitude of the wave doesn't change, the eccentricity amplitude of the wave doesn't change, the radial scale has to decrease so that the gradient of the gravity actually increases. And this is characteristic of all these waves, bending and spiral waves. And as you go away from the resonance, I get more and more tightly wound. Okay, now one of the hints that we didn't understand something in these waves was that they didn't damp as fast as our simple particle estimates suggested that they might. They seemed to hang around a lot longer. This was sort of frustrating, not being able to understand this. But there were bigger hints, and those bigger hints came from the uranium rings, from those narrow uranium rings. And those hints were that the uranium rings were not circles. All of them, essentially all of them, had some deviation being circles. In the case of the epsilon ring, the deviation, as I mentioned, was that of a Keplerian ellipse. And I have to change media here. I'm really terrible at this. This is some mathematical clips I made starting Friday night. Okay. So this is an example of what the epsilon ring looks like. Over the eccentricity exaggerated, instead of being 1% being maybe 0.1 or 0.2. And when we first got a couple of cuts from occultations across the epsilon ring years ago, shortly after the discovery of the rings of Uranus, these were made at 2 microns by Keith Matthews and Phil Mickelson at Caltech. We found that it had this sort of shape, and furthermore that it precessed. And now I'm going to show you a real-time display. Which I should speed it up a little more, but I'll be okay. So what's being shown here is, as I said, an exaggerated shape and also width of the epsilon ring. This is standing for the planet, so the scale of the ring for the planet is more or less okay, factor of 2 in radius. This particle here is orbiting at the speed that a particle would at this distance from the planet. That's what defines the time scale. And you see the ring is very slowly precessing. The particle is orbiting a couple times a day, and the ring is processing about 3.5 per day, a little less. And so this is what the epsilon ring is doing. Now, when this was first measured, we still didn't know the rotation rate of Uranus. It's really amazing. Uranus is covered with a sort of smoggy layer, and its rotation rate was absolutely unknown. Deviation to touches of lightness of the planet, Aries is a square of the spin velocity. But once we had the precession rate of the ring of Uranus, assuming that it was precessing just like a single particle of it would, we knew the rotation rate of Uranus during about 10%. Now, what's going on here? Well, all the particles in this ring at a given semi-major axis are moving on an orbit of the same orbital eccentricity and the same apsidal line position. They all have the same eccentricity and the same apsidal line position. The ones on the inner edge have a slightly smaller orbital eccentricity than the ones on the outer edge. That's why the width varies. I mentioned to you the width variation is about a factor of 5 between periaps and aplaps. This line is pointing, of course, to the periaps. And so these particles, as they move around, are ultimately getting compressed when they go past here, past periaps, and expanded when they go here. And that's going to be very important to my discussion why they're self-excited modes in these rings. Now, these particles, if they're in almost a monolayer, when they get compressed, the thickness of the material is going to, well, if they're almost in a fluid, rather, liquid, then when they go through the periaps, that liquid is going to have to get thicker. When they go through the apoaps, that liquid is going to have to get thinner. And it may seem that there's a symmetry here. When you go towards periaps, things get thinner. When you go out of away from periaps, the material gets thicker. But you have to remember, when you go towards periaps and the material thickens, there's a resistance to it becoming thicker from the sum, one sum of gravity, which is resisting puffing the material up vertically, and viscous stress. And when you come out away from periaps and the material comes this way and gets thinner, then viscosity is tending to keep it thicker. The gravity is tending to make it thinner, and so they're working in opposite directions. And this means that in this region, during the compression region, there's much higher viscosity. The viscosity due to particle collisions. And here, in the expansion region, there's lower viscosity. And this gives the receptor's heat engine to oscillation on the spring. And actually, it's responsible for the spring's eccentricity. It builds up the eccentricity. It builds it up until the eccentricity becomes so large, or the difference in eccentricity between inner and outer edge becomes sufficiently large that nonlinear damping sets over and limits this eccentricity gradient. So that's more or less that's what I want to say about this. It's also the case that all of these eccentric rings are wider at apoaps and narrower at periaps. And that's a necessary condition in order that the self-gravity of the ring speed up the precession of particles in the outer edge of the ring and slow down the precession of the inner edge of the ring to keep the thing a nice aligned looks like this. So if you want, you can think of this shape as being a standing density wave. They have a trailing density wave propagating outward from the inner edge to the outer edge and then reflecting back. There's a leading density wave to get a standing wave, just a shape. Now, we suspected way back when we first saw this that this might be the case. But since these rings are also maintained by Shepard satellites, we didn't know whether it was the older stability with the particle collisions that gave these eccentricities or whether it was perturbations due to the satellites. And that's what we now know. And that's what's now been solved by the Voyager, by the Cassini.
You say these saying any rain is, any viscous rain is continuously developing through the centrosphere?
No. What viscosity does is it tends to make primarily the rain to spread. If it has an overstable mode in it, it spreads a little faster unless there's something holding it together. Well, if what's holding it together then has to work a little harder, because it increases the net viscosity. So I'm not saying that every rain is going to have overstable modes. But it is, I think, true that every really dense rain will have overstable modes.
But the intensity is not related to the fact that it's possessive, is it?
No. No, it's not. Yes, Chris.
The aspect ratio of this rain is so small, it's radially thicker than it is vertically thick.
Oh, yeah, yeah. It's between 20 and 100 kilometers wide, 50,000 kilometers in radius, and maybe a few feet
thick. I thought that, and this was what was the goal of the, depended on the background density gradient being small.
No. Okay, we should be the specialists. Right, we're talking to the unwashed. You understand? excuse me. I'm just trying to compliment Chris. I'm also shut him up. okay. Yeah. Okay, so now I'm going to show you some more remarkable things. This wall, I don't think you can touch. Okay, so here's another mode of a narrow ring. This mode is found in the gamma ring of Uranus. It's a very interesting mode. It's exaggerated a little. And I have to say, I have a moment, a slight bit of doubt about whether I got the width variation right. Maybe a little bit more than that. I could change it if I had a few minutes. This ring is pulsating radially. You notice the rate at which it is pulsating radially. It's pulsating radially at the same rate that particles in the ring are going around. So this is a particle in a circular orbit. So see, the ring is at a maximum radius here. Again, so this is an axisymmetric, we call m equals zero mode of oscillation. And this ring has it. And its width also varies as its radius does. Although, as I said, I suspect I may not be wrong with it. Maybe this should be widest here and now or something. There's a perfectly good mode of the ring. It says that all these particles doing a dance, all the problems are doing a dance where they're all at apoapse at the same time, and then at periapse at the same time, and they're just phasing themselves. And they didn't have a dance master, or an aerobics instructor, or anything. All they had was dissipation, some particle collisions, and yet they excited themselves. This is very, very interesting. Okay, we have to move on.
So are you saying we extend this by the same overstability?
Oh, yeah. It's an economy of explanation. Okay, now, here's another ring. This is the delta ring. This is what the delta ring does. The delta ring is eccentric, but the planet is not in its focus. The planet is at the center. Now, when we first saw that, we said, oh, there must be a satellite in the 2-to-1 resonance with the overlocated particles in the ring. But none was found. And instead, this again turns out to be a self-centered mode. Now, look at what's happening in this case. In this case, I can say something they asked. I think it's orbiting twice as fast, or the thing is orbiting half as fast. It's the best part. Once again, a nice coherent motion of all the particles. It's a little harder to think about, but that's all it is. Okay, this is the delta. Again, of course, it's magic. And eccentricity and width. Not even radius, but ratio of rates. This is another narrow thing.
You could actually measure this elevation?
Of course you can measure this. They're very accurate. And you know, sometimes you get the feeling that all these years make progress, but actually, it did pretty well. Okay, now the final one. This is yet to be seen. This is yet to be seen in a narrow planetary ring. Although this geometry, this is a 3, cosine 3-5 distortion. This seen in the outer edge of Saturn's big rings, I better get to pretty soon. In this case, there's a sort of two-thirds ratio of the rate in which the ring rotates and the inverse clockwise. So this is a three-log pattern again, all exaggerated and so on. Okay, but as I said, not seen okay, now we come to the outer edge of the B ring. The outer edge of the B ring is held there by Mimas. We knew this for a long, long time. We even knew how, more or less. And momentum was flowing out through the particle collisions, and then it jumped from the outer edge of the B ring. It was extremely sharp. Mimas moved out the outer edge of the B ring. Of course, we moved out slowly with it, but it maintained this very, very sharp shape detector. The sharp shape is itself very impressive because the angular momentum is taken out by Mimas over 100 kilometers or so, yet the optical depth of the viewing in a certain sense remains essentially constant within 100 meters of the edge, or maybe better. It can never resolve better than that. Okay, at the time the Voyager went by, the outer edge of the viewing was pointing elongated into one of these ellipses, shaped like this, actually. Just like this, an M equals 2 shape. With Mimas out here, so the short axis pointed towards Mimas, I guess. And it was out of round by about 80 kilometers. It wasn't exactly pointed at Venus. Well, we only had a couple of pictures, and it was almost pointed at Venus. And so we said, oh, this is your understanding. But there were hints of trouble, and that is when images taken at different times were stretched so that they made a nice smooth outer edge. There was all sorts of structure inside those images which didn't line up. And this taught us, Scott Tremaine and me and Cole Watery, to predict that there could be unstable modes or overstable modes in the outer edge of the B-ring, which formed between a Lindblad resonance inside the outer edge, somewhat closer to the planet, and the sharp outer edge, in which waves would propagate, trailing waves would propagate from this these Lindblad resonances out to the outer edge, be reflected as leading waves, come back to the Lindblad resonance, turn around, bounce back and forth many times, so there would be a cavity here, and slowly amplify to to some viscous torque, which we actually calculated and showed with a triangular flow model or a liquid model or sort of grains, sort of thing people model flow of pills down conveyor belts in drug companies or grain down grain elevators in farms. Would give a slow amplification. An amplification which would take anything from the shorter waves to 10,000 or maybe 100,000 periods of orbit to maybe millions. What I'm going to tell you now is the piece of orbit of the Earth. They were observed by two groups. One group led by Matt Hedgen, who works with Phil Mickelson at Cornell. Another group, Joseph Vitale, who was working with Carol and Fleckers. And what they observed at the outer edge of the Beery were distortions due to M equals 1 Cantorian list that is a slowly rotating Cantorian list like what I showed you, the epsilon ring. So there's an amplitude of about 24 kilometers out around. M equals 2, planet-centered elliptical distortion with an amplitude that varied from 80 kilometers, 75 kilometers, to about 7 kilometers over time, over a few years. And then M equals 3 distortion with an amplitude of around 11 kilometers, 10 kilometers, like the one I just showed you. Okay, so now, they won't talk about this, and they called me up, and at least I did one small thing. I said, well, the fact that you're seeing a big variation in this M equals 2 pattern, big variation in amplitude, means that they have two M equals 2 modes, two M equals 2 distortions, the slightly different pattern speeds, and constructively and then destructively interfering. And when they're destructively interfering, they have M equals 2 is almost gone. When they're destructively interfering, they're very large. Okay, now what do these two do to? Well, one of these is forced by Minus, which is holding the average and the B-ring fixed. And the other one is a free oscillation, which is self-excited. This Grimblad resonance is a little inferior, and it drifts relative to the forced oscillation with a rate of about 5 degrees per day. I put that in a program system, a lot. Everything went fine. So now I'm going to show you a simulation of that, just to the end equals 2. This one takes a little while. So here we started with the with the 2 M equals 2, forced and free oscillations align. And we're just waiting. We have to wait until it's counting it somewhere around here. What you see emerging from behind these are two dash ellipses, which represent the two modes. Which were initially aligned, and so now it's starting to get out of line. And so, appearing relative to the sum of the two. Okay, so that's, what do we learn? Well, we've learned that there are self-excited modes. There's self-excited modes, as I said, n equals 1, n equals 2. M equals 3 near the outer edge of the B ring there aren't any satellites driving the N equals 1 or the N equals 3 modes, so these have to be self-sighted. There isn't any satellite driving the faster of the N equals 2 modes, so that's self-sighted as well. And there's no N equals 0 mode. This puzzled me for a while. No N equals 0 mode. Why shouldn't there be an N equals 0 mode? I said to the observer groups, look for the N equals 0 mode. And they reported it back, can't find it. And I said, come on, look on it. And they said, can't find it. And I thought about it a little and I realized that an N equals 0 axisymmetric wave can only propagate inward, not outward. And therefore, the N equals 0 wave can't give a mode at an outer edge, only at an inner edge. That's why it isn't there. So I go back and I said, you're honest people. Sorry. And you're both my students. What did I say? Okay, so there you see the N equals 2 mode starting to disappear. That's what they saw. Okay, that covers most of what I wanted to say. I'm sorry I didn't have time to prepare a little better.
The takeaway point is that you need spots to get an edge.
You only need one edge. Okay. In a narrow ring, they have a viscosity, if the density is high enough, so it behaves like angular flow, you get overstability. And you have two edges. You really only need one edge. Because the resonance itself can form the boundary to the cavity. And so one edge is enough. And then the proper sort of viscosity, you don't see these things in the A-ring, the outer edge of the A-ring. It's plenty sharp. The reason is that unless the viscosity is such, and it's dynamical chain that is the material compresses and contracts and drives its waves. You don't get any self-sighted colors. That's right. Yeah, I had some more pictures.
So why in this case the three rolling is sign rolling the same as two?
Well, that's a good question. Okay, let me, I've got one on my mind, so I can't answer the question. I can almost answer it, but not quite. Okay, I'll give you the approximate answer, and then let me finish my last line, and then I'll give you the approximate answer. Oh, people, I'll turn around for the last one more. This one has all the modes together. But since the M equals 2 is the biggest, most of us see it. Okay, why the amplitude is the same? Okay, well, the amplitudes are always saturated. When you have all these calculations I was talking about are linear calculations. Linear wave with viscosity. The wave only cares about self-gravity. Viscosity depends on particle collision. The pressure in the wave is negligible. But whenever you have a linear overstable disturbance, something is going to stop it when I'm getting too big. For example, stars don't explode when they oscillate. They get a certain amplitude, and then they bisect you a lot of light. Then they hang there. It always has to be a nonlinear process. Now, in this case, we can actually work out the nonlinear viscous damping. And we know that the viscous damping increases, I mean, viscous excitation increases until the gradient in the eccentricity, the gradient in the eccentricity becomes big enough. And the gradient that I'm referring to is ADEVA, at least for these standing waves. And this is related to the change in surface density between the widest and the narrowest part of the changeover from growth to damping occurs when that parameter is about 0.7 in all models. That would be true in any model. So self-excited waves, you would expect to grow until this parameter, ABEA, gets up to around 0.7. And that's true for the M equals 2 and M equals 3 self-excited modes. It seems that it's not true for the M equals 1 mode. That one gets to, seems to have hung up in a much smaller value of ABEA. We don't understand it. It's not understood. It may be telling us something very deep. So it's worth thinking about it a little more. And I'll think about it a little more, but we don't understand it. There's something else we don't understand. I've only talked about the modes which have zero nodes between the lid-lab resonance and the outer edge. Those are the only ones we've observed. But there's a whole innumerable number of modes for each n value. Maybe 1, 2, 3, 4. But there's more and more nodes. And only the nodeless modes have been observed. This is very similar to what we have in stars. When you have a large amplitude oscillation of a star, like a Cepheid or a Wiring, you don't see a whole bunch of overstable modes. You see only one, sometimes two, sometimes the radio, the spherically symmetric, nodeless mode, fundamental, and the first overtone. So in some way, nodeless mode is suppressing the others, but I don't understand how. It's something I actually can work out. I don't know how long, but I can work out. So that's another sort of addition. Now, how about the fact that the force mode is almost the same amplitude as the free mode? Why is that? That's also not so difficult. There's a question then of how hard the satellite has to distort the streamlines of flow, the ring, in order to keep the ring from spreading. And there we know that it has to distort the streamlines of flow sufficiently so that no more angular momentum is flowing towards the edge. It's worth saying. If you have two ellipses, the nested ellipses, the eccentricity gradient gets big enough, then the angular velocity where the ellipses are posted together actually, instead of decreasing outward, increases outward. That reverses the direction of angular momentum flow to the friction. And in order to hold an engine, you have to reach that condition over a significant range of azimuth. And that's why you get this ratio when you have a force wave containing an edge about the same value. Okay. That's about it. Now I've exhausted myself.
All the stuff has been taken over the lock, stock, and barrel by the exoplanet. All the waves, the gaps, shepherding, all this stuff. It works great for planetary rings. The planetary rings are very thin. They submit the perturbation field tremendously well. And also self-gravity dominates the propagation of the waves, and random motion will crush it. Normally a minor piece. In the case of planetary rings, self-gravity in general is not planetary discs, protoplanetary systems in discs The subgravity is subdominant to the pressure. And the pressure and viscosity are very much tied together. And the viscosity is just assumed to come from God. Whereas in fact, the viscosity is a dynamic variable. So, but here, in the planetary rings, the viscosity only makes changes fairly, very, very slowly over time. Because it's like the pressure, it's very subdominant. In current planetary disks, the viscosity makes changes quite rapidly. And it's not treated at all sensibly, as people recognize. They just put in an alpha. They say, oh, my disk has an alpha of so-and-so. Occasionally now, they start to do MRI, in which case they build in a transport. And then they get different results, actually, which is sort of scary. But, so I would say, yes, it has a lot of cautions. Maybe not too many in the lessons, but a lot of cautions that people recognize sometimes. And some of them find the planets embedded in disks if they're big enough, that their eccentricity is growing, and this kind of they have the eccentricity damping. It's much less clean.
That there will be up there, and if you want, we also have tape right there.
A new one.
Yeah.
I was talking to my wife, and she said, "Oh, I'm not going to